Let's go over some of the unique capabilities, constraints, and opportunities in AR. We've established that half of augmented reality is reality, aka the real world, and it's important to make pieces that respond to the real world. That's what makes AR unique, and there are lots of different ways to do this. Context is a really important tool in AR. Site-specific artwork has long known the power of context, but now we have this new opportunity to use context in many different ways much more easily. Image anchors are images that are linked to a digital layer. So, for example, you could create a painting or illustration that has digital animations and 3D objects that float on top of it. This means you can augment physical objects in the real world, things like t-shirts, art prints, and even packaging. As you may have noticed, we all have bodies. Yes, it's true, each our very own. And because of this, our brains are actually built to understand the world in terms of our bodies. We inherently understand the size of objects around us, as well as how near or far they are, because we are comparing them to our own body in space. This makes scale and proximity two really powerful tools when developing augmented reality. We can leverage these things to create more compelling, more directive, and more immersive experiences. Location is yet another great way of using context. Certain AR experiences can be located at specific GPS coordinates. This opens up all sorts of possibilities for site-specific work. Imagine designing a walking tour for travelers, or even providing historical context for certain city buildings. The possibilities are endless. AR experiences created with Adobe Aero will be viewed through a mobile device, either a phone or a tablet. And these devices only have a certain amount of screen real estate. So it's essential to keep that in mind when you're designing. First off, it's important to think about framing, especially the initial framing. I like to set a focal point a few feet in front of the participant. Then I adjust positioning and scale until they can easily see the whole composition, or at least the part I want them to focus on. Remember, this will be the first thing that your audience sees, so you want to make sure that they can actually see it. Otherwise, if it's too close or too large, it can feel disorienting and they won't really know where to start. Keep in mind that phones and tablets are small devices, so they have limited processing power. When we create AR experiences, we're asking these little computers to do a lot. They have to track surfaces in real time, manage 3D objects, juggle numerous triggers, and even animations. In order to keep a smooth experience, you really need to optimize your files. I'll cover specific optimization techniques more in depth later, but in general, try to keep your file sizes and frame rates as low as possible while maintaining fidelity. One thing to keep in mind is that designing for 3D is fundamentally different than designing for 2D. Since we are creating spatial experiences, we have to consider how to direct the eye in space. Luckily, there are a ton of pre-existing visual design principles that we can leverage and customize for our AR experiences. Scale, proximity, color, movement, and negative space are all wonderful tools for directing the eye, and I'll go into specific details about how to use these techniques in later videos. When creating spatial experiences, one of our biggest tasks is leading the participant. It's often overlooked, but audio is a really powerful tool for this. It's a great way to direct attention, to give additional information about objects or an environment, to respond to participants when they interact. Or, of course, it's a great way to bring emotion to a piece. Audio is a shortcut to the heart. Musicians and filmmakers have known this for a long, long time, but we need to bring those lessons into spatial design as well. In later videos, I'll go over different techniques for creating spatial audio using Adobe Aero. Interaction creates an opportunity for deeper connections with your audience. It's one of the key things that makes AR different from other passive mediums like film. So, as you can imagine, it's incredibly important. In future videos, I'll go over the ins and outs of designing interactions in augmented reality. I'll cover best practices, as well as go over behaviors, triggers, and how to use them. Now that I've laid down the groundwork for what AR is and what it can uniquely do, I'll leave you with a final question, which is something that I ask myself at the beginning of every project. Why AR? It's always important to question why AR is the right fit for a particular project. What are the unique capabilities or features of AR that you can utilize to better communicate with your audience?